Hello dear students, today we are going to talk about one of the carbohydrate metabolism pathway, that is glycolysis. I am Dr. Vishwajit Ghorpade, working as assistant professor in pharmaceutics at Sanjay Ghodawat University, Kolhapur. The learning objectives of today's lecture will be, after completion of this lecture, you will be able to state various metabolic pathways of carbohydrates. You will be able to describe the glycolysis and the energetics involved in the glycolytic pathway. You will be able to enlist the significance of glycolysis. First, let us talk about the carbohydrate metabolism. In case of carbohydrate metabolism, glucose is always considered as a central molecule. This is because whichever higher carbohydrates are there, such as polysaccharides, during their metabolism, they are first converted into glucose, and then glucose further undergoes various oxidative pathways or synthetic pathways. Now, the major metabolic pathways of glucose have been shown over here. In case of glucose, let us see the oxidative pathways which are involved. The glucose can undergo glycolysis, where it gets converted into pyruvate and lactate. Secondly, glucose can get involved in hexose monophosphate shunt, where it gets converted into carbon dioxide and water at last. And thirdly, glucose can also undergo uronic acid pathway, where the final products will be glucuronic acid and pentoses. So these are all the oxidative pathways which the glucose undergoes. Secondly, the glucose can also undergo certain synthetic pathways. For example, glucose, it can be helpful in the synthesis of galactose and fructose. The glucose also gets involved in synthesis of glycogen. The process is known as glycogenesis. Glucose also gets involved in synthesis of fats, where the process is known as lipogenesis. And last, glucose also helps in synthesis of non-essential amino acids. Now let us see what are the other metabolic pathways. The first one is citric acid cycle, which involves oxidation of acetyl coenzyme A to carbon dioxide. Second one is gluconeogenesis, where there is synthesis of glucose within our body. Keep one thing in mind that neogenesis means regeneration. And hence gluconeogenesis is nothing but it is regeneration of glucose within our body. The third is glycogenolysis, which means breakdown of glycogen to glucose. The fourth metabolic pathway is galactose metabolism, where galactose will be converted to glucose, or it can also involve synthesis of lactose. The fifth important metabolic pathway is fructose metabolism, where fructose is oxidized to pyruvate. And the last one is amino sugar and mucopolysaccharide metabolism. Now let us talk about glucose uptake by the cells. Here you can observe the glucose molecule. If this glucose molecule wants to enter into the cell, that is the cytosol, it has to cross this cell membrane. But when it tries to cross the cell membrane will not allow the glucose to enter into the cytosol by simple diffusion. This is because the glucose molecule is hydrophilic in nature and the cell membrane is made up of phospholipids. And that is why if this glucose molecule wants to enter into the cytosol, it will require a special transportation system. And this transportation system consists of glucose transporters. Now, which are these glucose transporters? Let us see. The first one is glucose transporter 1, which is present in RBC, blood-brain barrier, and to some extent in heart. Second one is glucose transporter 2, which is present in liver, pancreas, and small intestine. Third one is glucose transporter 3, which is present in brain, neurons, sperms. Fourth one is glucose transporter 5, which is present in enterocyte of intestinal epithelium. Means it is present towards the inner side, or you can say it is present in the lumen of the intestine. And the last one is glucose transporter 4, which is present in the skeletal muscle, adipose tissue and heart. Now there are some other transporters too, for example, glucose transporter 7, sodium dependent glucose transporters, but I have not taken them over here. Okay. Now the transporters which I have shown you over here, amongst them, the first four transporters which are there, that is 1, 2, 3 and 5, are insulin independent transport systems, means they do not depend upon insulin to transport glucose within the cell. On the other hand, the glucose transporter 4, it is an insulin dependent transport system, means glucose transporter 4 requires insulin in order to transport glucose within the cytosol. Now, as this glucose transporter 4 requires insulin to transport the glucose within the cell, in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, where there is deficiency of insulin, the number of these glucose transporter 4 transporters decreases to a greater extent. As such, the glucose cannot enter into the cytosol. And if this thing happens, the glucose will stay in blood plasma and the blood glucose level will increase. Now let us talk about glycolysis. Glycolysis is nothing but it is the sequence of reactions which convert glucose to pyruvate or lactate with production of ATPs. Keep one thing in mind that in case of aerobic glycolysis, glucose will be converted to pyruvate, but in case of anaerobic glycolysis, glucose will be converted to lactate. Means the process will be same, only the different thing which will happen in case of anaerobic glycolysis is that glucose will first get converted to pyruvate and at end pyruvate will get converted into lactate. Now this term glycolysis, it is composed from two Greek words, that is glycose, which means sweet or sugar, and second one is lysis, which means breakdown. Now this glycolysis is often referred as Emden-Meyerhof pathway in the honor of two scientists, that is Gustav Emden and Otto Meyerhof, who played a major role to put forth this pathway in front of world. They were the first to understand the process of glycolysis. There is also another scientist called Jacob Parnas, whose name is also linked to this process. In that case, in most of the books, this pathway is known as Emden-Meyerhof-Parnas pathway, that is EMP pathway. Now let us see what are the phases of glycolysis. There are three phases of glycolysis. In first phase, there is investment of energy. We call it as priming stage. So the first stage will be energy investment phase, that is the priming stage. The second phase is the splitting phase, and the third phase is energy generation phase. Now what is involved in case of energy investment phase? In energy investment phase, you will see the conversion of glucose to fructose 1,6 biphosphate. Means in this priming stage, glucose will be converted to fructose 1,6 biphosphate. In splitting phase, there will be splitting of fructose 1,6 biphosphate to glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. And in case of energy generation phase, there will be conversion of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate to pyruvate. Okay, so you have to remember these phases. The first phase is priming stage, that is the energy investment phase, where glucose will be converted to fructose 1,6 biphosphate. In splitting phase, this fructose 1,6 biphosphate will be splitted to glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and DHAP, that is dihydroxyacetone phosphate. And at last, in energy generation phase, where ATP will be generated, glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate will be converted to pyruvate. Now let us talk about the enzymes involved in this glycolysis pathway. If we understand these enzymes, it will be more easier for us to understand the entire glycolysis pathway. Now, there are total 10 enzymes involved in the glycolytic pathway. The first one is hexokinase. Keep one thing in mind that kinase enzyme deals with transfer of phosphate group. Means it will either cause addition of phosphate group or it will cause the removal of phosphate group in a reaction. Let us see how. Here you can see a simple reaction where reactant A is getting converted into product B. Now, if this reaction is catalyzed by enzyme A kinase, see that here the prefix is A, that is the name of the reactant. Okay. Now, if the kinase is associated with name of reactant, in that case, keep one thing in mind that there will be phosphorylation of the reactant in this reaction. Okay. Means if the prefix is the name of the reactant, at that time there will be addition of phosphate group to this reactant, and then the product will be formed which will contain that phosphate group. And this addition of phosphate group is done by ATP over here. The ATP is going to give its one phosphate to this reactant and get converted to ADP, and this final product which is formed over here, that is B, it will contain the phosphate group. In second reaction, if the enzyme which is catalyzing the same reaction is B kinase. Now see, the prefix is B, which is nothing but the name of the product. So if B kinase is catalyzing this reaction, then exactly opposite will happen. That is, there will be loss of phosphate group. Means if your A reactant is already containing a phosphate group and this reaction is catalyzed by B kinase where prefix is the name of the product, then in that case the phosphate group present in the A reactant will be removed by this ADP. This ADP will take that phosphate group, get converted into ATP, and the product B will be formed where phosphate group will not be present now. The other enzymes involved are phosphohexose isomerase. See that the isomerase enzyme always deals with conversion of one isomer to another. The third enzyme is phosphofructokinase. Again, it is a kinase, so its work will be addition or removal of phosphate. Fourth is aldolase. In case of aldolase, remember that it deals with formation of aldol. Now, what is an aldol? The compound which you can see towards the right is nothing but the aldol. Means it contains an aldehyde group, where R3 over here will contain hydrogen. So here there will be an aldehyde group, and to this aldehyde there will be one carbon which is attached to hydroxy group. Means a compound which is containing aldehyde as well as hydroxy group, we are going to call it as a aldol. The fifth enzyme is phosphotriose isomerase. Again, it is isomerase, means it will deal with conversion of one isomer to another isomer. The sixth enzyme is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. Here, dehydrogenase enzyme always deals with removal of hydrogen, or it deals with oxidation. The seventh enzyme is phosphoglycerate kinase. The eighth enzyme is phosphoglycerate mutase. In case of mutase enzyme, remember that it catalyzes the movement of functional group. Means in a compound containing functional group, mutase will only deal with movement of functional group from one position to another position. Ninth enzyme is enolase. As in case of aldolase, it deals with formation of aldol. In case of enolase, it will deal with formation of enol. Now, what is an enol? The enol is a compound which is containing carbon-carbon double bond, and to one of this carbon which is involved in the double bond, one hydroxy group will be attached to it. So this is an enol. And the last enzyme is pyruvate kinase, which is the 10th enzyme. Now, let us move towards the actual glycolytic pathway, means the reactions which are involved in the glycolytic pathway. Starting with energy investment phase, which is also known as priming stage. Here, glucose is getting converted into glucose 6-phosphate. This is the first priming reaction, okay? Means here, the energy investment is going to take place. You can see here that for conversion of glucose to glucose 6-phosphate, ATP is getting involved. ATP is going to give its phosphate to the glucose, and hence glucose 6-phosphate will be formed, and ATP is going to get converted to ADP. And that is why Here, there is investment of ATP, investment of energy. The enzyme involved in this reaction is hexokinase. Why? Because here, phosphate group is added to the glucose. Okay, now see here, hexokinase is having the prefix hexo, which is also known as glucokinase. Okay, this hexokinase is also known as glucokinase. So this hexo or gluco, it is the prefix related to the reactant, and so there is addition of phosphate group. Okay, now you can see the actual changes which happen in the chemical structure over here. This is the cyclic structure of glucose. You can see the carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6 carbon over here. When there is addition of phosphate, phosphate group is going to get attached to the carbon which is at 6th position. In the second step, glucose 6-phosphate is going to get converted into fructose 6-phosphate. Here you can see the structure of glucose 6-phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate. If you count the number of carbons, hydrogen and oxygen in both the structures, also the number of phosphate groups in both the structures, you will see that these numbers are same in both the structures. Means these both structures are having same number of carbon, same number of hydrogen, same number of oxygen, same number of phosphate groups. Only the difference is in the structures. This means these two compounds, that is glucose 6-phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate, are isomers of each other. And so the enzyme which catalyzes this reaction is phosphohexose isomerase. In third step, fructose 6-phosphate is going to get converted into fructose 1,6-biphosphate. Here also, ATP is going to give one phosphate to this fructose 6-phosphate to form fructose 1,6-biphosphate. Means now the fructose 1,6-biphosphate compound will contain two phosphate groups. As ATP is utilized in this reaction, we are going to call it as a second priming reaction. Okay, you can see the structure of fructose 6-phosphate over here, where phosphate group is attached towards the left hand carbon atom of the fructose 6-phosphate structure. In case of fructose 1,6-biphosphate, another phosphate group is attached towards the right hand side. Okay, means the carbon which is present towards right hand side of this fructose, to that carbon one more phosphate group is attached over here. Now the enzyme which will be involved over here again will be a kinase enzyme. So it is phosphofructokinase. See that phosphofructo, it is related to this fructose 6-phosphate. Means this name phosphofructo is related to the reactant, and hence there is addition of phosphate. So the enzyme is phosphofructokinase. In fourth step, fructose 1,6-biphosphate will be splitted, because this is a splitting phase now. So fructose 1,6-biphosphate is going to get splitted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. See that during splitting, there will be cleavage of this 6-carbon sugar phosphate, that is 6-carbon fructose 1,6-biphosphate, to 2-3-carbon sugar phosphates. Okay, means here your 6-carbon sugar phosphate is going to get splitted into two compounds which are containing 3 carbons each. And the enzyme involved over here will be aldolase. Why? Because there is formation of aldol over here. You can see that in this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate structure, if you observe this portion, it is containing aldehyde group and hydroxy group attached to this CH, and that is why this is a aldol. So aldolase enzyme will be used in this process, and this reaction is a reversible reaction. Now once this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and DHAP, that is dihydroxyacetone phosphate, are formed, this dihydroxyacetone phosphate again gets converted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, because it is a reversible process. Okay, again you can see two structures over here. Now this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and DHAP which is formed, amongst them the DHAP again gets converted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate due to the enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. Now see, this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and DHAP are isomers of each other. If you count the number of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and phosphate atoms over here, they will be same, only the structure is different. And that is why these two are isomers of each other. And in presence of this enzyme, that is triose phosphate isomerase, DHAP is going to get converted into glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. Now if DHAP gets converted into glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, then there will be formation of two glyceraldehyde 3 phosphates from fructose 1,6 biphosphate. So below you will see that glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is formed, and in bracket 2 is written, means two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate are formed. First one is the original glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, which is generated from fructose 1,6 biphosphate, and second one is generated from DHAP due to this enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. Now comes the energy generation phase, where glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, now here there are two molecules. Now I am not always going to say that there are two molecules, this in bracket two molecules are written, you can easily understand it. I am just going to focus on the single molecule over here. Now once the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is generated over here, this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is going to get converted to 1,3 biphosphoglycerate. Now for this process, there is addition of phosphate group, and also there is oxidation of this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate to form 1,3 biphosphoglycerate. Therefore, this reaction involves oxidation, that is oxidation of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. Now who causes the oxidation of this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate? It is NAD, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide plus. Okay, means NAD plus is going to cause oxidation of this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. And this NAD plus, it is going to oxidize glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, and itself it is going to get reduced to form NADH. And also there is phosphorylation, means phosphate group is also added over here, and therefore now there is formation of compound which is containing two phosphate groups, and there is formation of a glycerate compound over here. So if you see the structure, in first structure you can see glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate over here, and in second structure you can see one more phosphate group is attached over here. Okay, means this hydrogen which was present in the aldehyde group, this hydrogen is removed, it goes and gets attached to this NAD, and instead there comes a phosphate group which gets attached to this carbonyl carbon. So from glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, 1,3 biphosphoglycerate is formed. Now which enzyme will be involved in this reaction? See that there is oxidation of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate in this reaction, means only there is dehydrogenation of hydrogen of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, and therefore the enzyme involved over here will be glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate dehydrogenase. In next step, 1,3 biphosphoglycerate which is formed, it is going to get converted to 3 phosphoglycerate, means amongst the two phosphate group attached in this molecule of 1,3 biphosphoglycerate, one phosphate is going to get removed by this ADP, and there will be formation of ATP. Now as there is formation of ATP, this is the energy generation reaction. So it is said over here that it is the first ATP forming reaction, and it is also known as substrate level phosphorylation. See that in substrate level phosphorylation, always the ADP is going to remove the phosphate group from your compound, and there will be formation of ATP. So you will find that the phosphate group which is attached to this carboxylic acid group of 1,3 biphosphoglycerate is going to get removed in this reaction, and there will be formation of 3 phosphoglycerate. So in this reaction, phosphate group is removed, and hence the enzyme, you can easily predict it, which will be involved over here. It will be, of course, a kinase enzyme, that is phosphoglycerate kinase. See here the phosphoglycerate which is written over here. This name is related to the product now. And so there is removal of phosphate group. In next step, 3-phosphoglycerate is going to get converted to 2-phosphoglycerate. Okay, means what is happening over here in this reaction? the phosphate group of 3-phosphoglycerate is just changing its position. Initially, it was present at 3rd carbon of this glycerate compound. Now, it will be shifted to the 2nd carbon of this glycerate compound. Means there is only interchanging in the position of this phosphate and the hydroxy group, or hydrogen of the hydroxy group, I will say. And so, there is formation of 2-phosphoglycerate over here. So, if there is change in the position of a functional group, the enzyme involved will be phosphoglycerate mutase enzyme over here. In next step, 2-phosphoglycerate is going to get converted into phosphoenol pyruvate due to loss of water molecules over here. So you will see that in case of 2-phosphoglycerate molecule, the water molecule is getting removed, means this hydroxy group over here, which is attached to the 3rd carbon of glycerate compound, and the hydrogen which is attached to the 2nd carbon, they will come together and water molecule will be formed, which will be removed, and there will be a double bond formation in between this CH2 and this carbon. So there is formation of double bond over here. Now enol compound is formed over here. Now how can we say that enol is formed? You will see that there is a double bond and there is one oxy group present over here. Instead of H, there is present of phosphate group over here. That is why we are going to call it as a enol compound only. We call it as a phosphoenol, because instead of hydrogen over here attached to the oxygen, there is presence of phosphate group. So the phosphate group is attached to oxygen instead of hydrogen, so we are going to call it as phosphoenol pyruvate compound. And this thing happens due to the enzyme enolase. In last step, phosphoenol pyruvate, which was formed previously, is going to get converted into pyruvate. Now this step is also a energy generation step, where ADP is going to remove the phosphate from this phosphoenol pyruvate and ATP will be formed. So it is a second ATP forming reaction. Again, it is a substrate-enabled phosphorylation, because ADP is removing the phosphate and ATP is getting formed over here. And so final product is pyruvate. You can see over here the phosphate group was present on the 2nd carbon of the phosphoenol pyruvate compound, and now it is going to get removed over here. So the final product is not containing any phosphate group. So the pyruvate is not containing any phosphate group. And in this step, the enzyme which will be involved will be pyruvate kinase, because it is dealing with removal of phosphate. Now let us talk about the energetics of this glycolysis. In various steps, there was either use of ATP or generation of ATPs. For example, if you again repeat this video, you will come to know that in step 1, where glucose is getting converted to glucose 6-phosphate, one ATP was utilized, because the phosphate group which was added to the glucose, that was added by the ATP. So one ATP was utilized, so I am writing it as minus 1. ATP used is indicated as minus 1, and ATP generated is indicated by plus number. So in step 1, ATP is used, so only one ATP was used, so I have written it as minus 1. In step 3, where fructose 6-phosphate is getting converted to fructose 1,6-phosphate, or fructose 1,6-biphosphate we can say, here again one ATP was utilized, so we have written minus 1. In step 6, where glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is getting converted to 1,3-biphosphoglycerate, 5 ATPs were formed. Now how 5 ATPs were formed, that is the question. Keep one thing in mind, that nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide hydrogen always gives us 2.5 ATPs when it gets involved in the electron transport chain. Okay, so in that reaction, that is in step 6, you will find that 2 NADH is formed, means 2 NAD plus are going to oxidize 2 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, and there will be generation of 2 NADH. And if there are 2 NADH formed in this step, this means there will be 5 ATP generated in the electron transport chain, which comes further. Therefore, there are 5 ATPs formed. In step 7, we have seen the conversion of 1,3 biphosphoglycerate to 3 phosphoglycerate, where two ATPs were generated. Two ADPs are giving phosphate groups to two molecules of 1,3 biphosphoglycerate to give two molecules of 3 phosphoglycerate. So, two ATPs are formed in this reaction. And in step 7, where two molecules of phosphoenol pyruvate are getting converted into two molecules of pyruvate. Again here, two ADPs are going to take two phosphate groups and there will be formation of two ATPs. So, plus 2 is written. Now, if we consider the total ATPs produced in this glycolysis, it will be minus 1, minus 1, plus 5, plus 2, plus 2. The answer will be plus 7. So, 7 ATPs are generated in this glycolysis pathway. The overall equation of this glycolysis reaction can be written in this way. Glucose plus 2 NAD plus, plus 2 ADP plus 2 phosphate groups will give you 2 pyruvate molecules plus 2 NADH plus 2 H plus ions plus 2 ATP plus 2 H2O. If you try to resolve this overall equation, then you can get two processes over here, exergonic process and endergonic process. In exergonic process, glucose is going to react with 2 NAD plus to generate 2 pyruvate, 2 NADH and 2 protons. And in this reaction, the standard free energy change will be minus 146 kilojoules per mole. In case of endergonic process, two ADPs will take two phosphates to form two ATPs and two water molecules. And in this endergonic process, standard free energy will be equal to, or standard free energy change will be equal to 61 kilojoules per mole. Okay, so these two processes, if you combine them, you are going to get again the overall equation only. Okay, you can try it. All right, so if you want to determine the overall standard free energy change, then you have to add the standard free energy change of exergonic reaction and standard free energy change of endergonic reaction. So the overall standard free energy change will be delta GS0 will be equal to delta G10 plus delta G20, which will be equal to minus 146 plus 61, which will be again equal to minus 85 kilojoule per mole. So this is the overall standard free energy change for glycolytic pathway. And at last, let us see the significance of glycolysis. There are 6 significance points of glycolysis. The first point is that it occurs in all the cells of the body. It is the only pathway which occurs in all the cells of our body. Secondly, it is the only source of energy in erythrocytes. Means if erythrocytes want energy, only glycolysis is the pathway which they can utilize to generate energy. Third significance point is that during strenuous exercise, where your muscles require more energy, that energy will be provided by anaerobic glycolysis. The fourth point of significance is that glycolysis is the preliminary step. It is the first step before complete oxidation of any carbohydrate molecule. Fifth point of significance is that glycolysis pathway provides carbon skeleton for the synthesis of non-essential amino acids. Okay, it's whichever non-essential amino acids are there, the carbon skeleton of those non-essential amino acids is provided by the glycolysis pathway. Also, it provides the carbon skeleton for the glycerol of the fatty acids in case of lipid synthesis. And the last significance point is that the reversible reactions in the glycolysis can also be used for gluconeogenesis. Now, in this entire glycolysis pathway, there were certain steps which were reversible. So these reversible reactions can be used for gluconeogenesis. So with this, I think that now you have understood what is the process of glycolysis, what is its energetics and its significance. Thank you.